Good morning. Good morning. My name is Patricia Provot. I'm president of Armstrong International in the Americas. I started 22 years ago as an energy engineer, working on energy savings, helping customers improve thermal utilities. So a true passion for energy efficiency and decarbonization, which will be the topic today. But before we dive into it, let me introduce Steve Skarda. He's our guest today. And the reason, Steve, why you are here today is you have been a super visible voice on thermal decarbonization, particularly through the RTC. So can I ask you to introduce yourself?
Yeah, absolutely. It's great to talk to you, Patricia. I've been working with P&G for 25 years. The last decade or so, I've owned their energy and greenhouse gas program. And where we are today, I own all of our technical solutions around greenhouse gas innovation. So really focused on technical innovation to drive our operations to zero greenhouse gas emissions.
So today we will be talking about decarbonization and particularly the decarbonization of thermal utilities. Because thermal utilities have shown to be a significant challenge for the industry, as there is really not an easy, financially reasonable button to push. So we'll focus this session today on the light industry. And by light industry, I mean industries using thermal energy, but mostly at lower temperatures. So 150 Celsius, 300 Fahrenheit and below. Industries such as food, pharma, consumer products. So I want to start by framing that challenge a bit for our audience today, and then talk about methodology to decarbonization, and finally technologies available. So let's start by framing the challenge. In the plant portfolio that you manage, or overall in the light industry, what is typically the proportion of emissions produced by thermal activities compared to the total CO2 emissions? Is thermal really a big part of the pie?
Yeah, absolutely. So in our company, within Procter & Gamble, we have multiple business units. And when you look across all of them, greenhouse gas emissions, before doing any renewable electricity work, were about split half between electricity and the other half thermal energy. But keep in mind that really the actual split of how we use energy, about two-thirds of our energy is used for thermal needs and a third of it is used for electricity. Now, we have different businesses and each business is a little different. Diapers are more focused on electricity. We have one very energy intensive business, which is making Bounty and Charmin. And plus that is more focused on the thermal side and drying paper. But in general, across the industry, and this isn't reflective of just light industry, but as we've looked at members of the Renewable Thermal Collaborative, a group of companies that have come together to work on thermal, two-thirds thermal is pretty typical for industry.
So not a small piece of the pie, definitely.
Well, it's a huge challenge, right? I mean, all of the work that's been going on over the last decade has really been focused on electricity. And, you know, when you read articles that are about renewable electricity, sometimes they'll say renewable energy, but they say when you read the details, they're talking about renewable electricity, the policy, the innovation. You know, a lot of the articles are about solar and wind, and that's all really important. But there really is this huge challenge in how we use thermal energy. Today, it's mostly natural gas.
As we started at looking at decarbonizing this light industry, Steve, and as we map energy usage in this type of industry, one of the things that becomes quickly evident is that we have a significant amount of energy that goes wasted at very low temperatures that until now really had not been a focus. When I say waste, through the heat coming out of the chillers, for example, the cooling of compressors, cooling of a product, actually a good percentage of electricity used in a plant gets wasted through just low grade waste heat. Have you been in again, your portfolio, the typical light industry, have you been able to estimate in your type of industry what percentage of energy really is lost through that low-grade waste heat?
Well, I love the fact that you started the conversation there, because it's one of the first things we are focused on. We not just in the energy space, but for all manufacturing, really have a vision for a zero loss manufacturing operation. And you're exactly right. Where does that electricity go? Well, it really all ends up as heat. And you just said that, whether it's, friction in a bearing or moving product around, it's heat. Now, a lot of that heat we actually pull back out, right? We have chillers and chilled water, and we cool those processes, and then we throw it all out to cooling towers. And that's a loss. You're 100% correct. How much of a loss is that? We are just starting to learn about that, actually with partnerships with companies like Armstrong, where you're really helping us go and map all of our places where we're doing using chilled water and cooling water, where we cooling the processes, but then really looking at every one of our thermal loads. One of the things that's been interesting through a lot of that work is to recognize our core source of energy is steam. Well, natural gas and biomass in a few sites, but natural gas generates steam. But really, that steam goes to the process, and then it goes through a heat exchanger, and then we're using hot water. And so really starting to think about, well, one, can we, rather than throw all that heat out to cooling towers, and if I got heat coming out of an air compressor that we're cooling, can we grab that heat and then either through the heat exchanger or a heat pump, put that into hot water, and then not even have to generate that steam in the first place? And so it's really all about zero loss, right? Let's look at where the energy is flowing. Energy is neither created nor destroyed. That's sort of theoretical, but practically speaking, there is still a lot of energy that's leaving our site that we can go and grab and actually use effectively in our process.
Yeah, it's interesting that you talk about that. Indeed, Armstrong over the last years here has really spent a lot of time trying to envision what the thermal systems of the future look like, particularly in the light industry. And several conclusions come out of that. It's like you just said, if you're using in your plant, if you're mainly heating to 120 Celsius, 250 Fahrenheit, you really don't need steam. You can work with hot water. It's way more efficient. Also less maintenance, so an easier system to manage. So that was the first conclusion. But the second conclusion, as we think through how do we move these thermal utilities to decarbonized utilities, is that in order to decarbonize a plant, the right methodology is first looking at minimizing energy, optimizing the thermal system, because when you do that, you can really reduce up to 50% of your, reduces 50% of your CO2 emissions. And then it's when you have done that, then you can start looking at decarbonizing the generation piece. So what do you think about that methodology of energy efficiency first, then decarbonizing? By energy efficiency, I mean de-steaming the system, recovering that low-grade waste heat that we were talking about. Because this is really a lot of work for the plants, right? That's not an easy button to start with that efficiency first. But why would somebody follow that methodology?
Well, I think you described it exactly right. And actually, I have a visual that we share internally, which is, as we start to really help folks understand, what does the journey look like? There is always just efficiency. That's always the first thing we're doing with, let's try not to use energy in the first place. And then there's, you use the word optimization, which I like a lot. And that's sort of a blend of both efficiency and electrification. But it comes back to the topic we just talked, right? We're going to be zero loss. We're going to keep all that heat internal to our process. And then from there, we move into just more general electrification, electro boilers, move beyond heat pumps to actual electrification, and then renewable fuels, and maybe even to the point where we're looking at carbon capture. But that journey, that is sort of also the way we prioritize it and work on it first, second, third. It's efficiency first. Now we're really trying to tackle optimization. The thing that's actually really hard about the optimization work that I find is for decades, it's been really easy to get steam, right? So if I'm a process designer, it doesn't matter what kind of thermal energy I need. I just go to the nearest steam line, grab some steam and use it in my process. But what that means is we have this infrastructure that's so dependent on steam and sometimes high pressure steam, even when I didn't need high pressure steam. And so I have all these heat exchangers and platforms and processes that were designed around that. I kind of got to go and reverse back out of that. And so we're really relearning how to think differently about thermal energy. Yes, steam is a really great way to move large amounts of energy around the site. But if ultimately that means we're losing opportunities to use some of that waste heat or leverage some heat pumps, we need to rethink our infrastructure differently as well. But that is the work that we're doing. Absolutely.
No, rethinking, indeed. When you, in the past, focused on energy savings and now complete decarbonization, it's a different mindset. The other thing that we noticed, we have engineers working on all these decarbonization roadmaps here in the recent years. And something that we really started discovering through education experience is that it's very important, if your focus is on decarbonization, it's to, as you do the thermal mapping of these plants, that you look at a good pinch assessment also. You understand all your heat sources, you understand all of your heat sinks, but then with pinch, you really know how to match this to really get to the lowest level of energy possible, the best heat recovery possible, the best heat exchanger network design, like they call it in pinch. And honestly, this has been eye-opening to me, because until now the industry has focused on energy savings and big wins, returns below the 3 years. And when you're focused on that, you're actually very often violating pinch and actually reducing your chances of getting to minimum energy consumption. And so now you have to look at that completely differently. If at the end of the day you want to, once you're at zero, be at your minimum OPEX and your minimum CAPEX. So that was truly a discovery as we started focusing more towards decarbonization versus energy savings. And I don't think there has been enough education on that in the industry. So I think that's something definitely we as Armstrong, we want to educate a bit more on.
Yeah, I think it's especially true for the light industry. For me as well, there are industries, especially those that are very thermally intensive, where a pinch analysis in a process is something that they just do as part of their normal engineering process. Within light industry, honestly, that's not something that we have experience doing. When I look internally, it's our process engineers, the thermal experts, we have really amazing engineers, but that is not something that's been part of our normal process design, partly because we have different needs than large and different cost structures, but that is the work we need to do now. So to your point, educating and really starting to integrate that kind of thinking into our process design going forward is exactly what we're doing.
No, thank you. Thank you for that insight. So we talked a bit, we framed the light industry. We talked a bit about methodology. Let's talk a bit about technology to end the conversation today. You are in charge of sustainability globally. Do you see different technologies, methodologies applied around the world?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, the technology is the most fascinating part of this work. It's really where the breakthroughs, I believe, are going to happen in the next several years. It's really a lot of how we're going to solve the rest of that equation. And there are a lot of really tough problem statements to work through in those areas. And so, you know, sometimes we have technologies that are very, that are proven, that I can go out and find projects where they're, you know, using hydrogen or using biomethane or biogas and some of these other carbon capture, you name it. But then ultimately, how do we look across 130 facilities and then actually really transform where we are to those? We are looking at how do we do that at scale? How do we ensure that we have solutions that will work in multiple places? In the past, I'll say 5 years ago, when I was thinking about how do I find a solution to a problem, a lot of what I was focused on was really finding a unique situation. Maybe I have a unique set of biomass here and an incentive, and that's that one place now I can solve it, I can go do a project. Where we're at today is no, that doesn't work. We need to take these technologies and think about how do we decarbonize at scale. Some of that is methodology. I think that's what you said. What is our methodology to go in and do evaluations across many sites in a very efficient way? But then also we're thinking about, well, what does our platform look like? Can we have the same have a partnership where we're really building the same utility type systems in multiple across many sites, across even regions where possible. So that's a lot of where our thinking is going into how do we innovate today.
Speaking about technology, the one technology Armstrong is extremely excited about is the high temperature industrial heat pumps. We believe they will be a critical part of decarbonizing the light industry because they really allow to recover all that low grade waste heat and go up to 120 Celsius to 250 Fahrenheit. Do you see that the same way? And what are some of the challenges that you see there?
Yeah, 100%. And my thinking on and that has changed as well. So when I used to hear think about high temperature heat pumps above 100 degrees Celsius, my assumption, which now I realize is incorrect, but my assumption was, well, the COPs, the efficiencies that you get out of those heat pumps go down significantly when you're trying to get those kind of temperatures. And really, as we've been learning with you, there are heat pump manufacturers and heat pumps out there that really can still get up to 120 degrees Celsius and still do it at the kind of COPs. We were just visiting you a month ago and we're looking at an actual system that was running around 3. And so if I can use electricity and move 3 times as much energy from one place to another and get steam type of temperatures, well, that solves a lot of problems for me now, right? So now rather than trying to think about how do I stay at low temperatures and still meet my process needs, I can actually still get those higher temperatures, but still leverage the beauty of a heat pump, the fact that I can move 3 times as much heat as it takes to put into that system. So yeah, very excited about that. That has a lot of potential for us for sure.
Well, thank you, Steve. Thank you. Thank you for sharing your insights. Again, you have been that voice of thermal decarbonization in a lot of places. Thank you for your time today. But before we leave, with all your time and experience in this role, is there any advice you would give to other sustainability engineers, managers that are in a similar position?
Yeah, absolutely. The first, and I find companies are across the spectrum. There's a lot of companies like Armstrong and P&G that are committed to zero emissions. They have their goal. And then others that are really just at the very beginning, maybe don't have goals and trying to figure it out. So the first step is obviously understand the science, commit to this work needs to be done because it absolutely must be done. We need to decarbonize our operations. And then from there, okay, so I'm committed. I understand this is what we need to do. Start building those roadmaps. I mean, for us, and it feels a little scary at first, right? I mean, we have a really low cost supply of energy today. It serves our business very well. The idea of trying to find replacements for that can feel a little daunting. But as you get into it and you find really good partners, when you collaborate with others, you find that there are solutions. There's some near-term solutions that are ready now, like the optimization that we talked. And then as we work together and collaborate and work on innovation and technical solutions, there are roadmaps. I'm very confident as we start to look at the next 5 to 10 years and where we see both the technology and the infrastructure going, the roadmaps are there and they're starting to get a lot clearer to us. So take those steps, start building a roadmap, build a goal, and then work on your roadmap. Those are the two things that I encourage other companies to do. And don't be intimidated by it. It can be a little daunting at first, but as you start to really dig in the details and you start to understand what the possibilities are, you start to see the light. And it's like, oh, this is possible. We can do this.
Thank you. Thank you a lot, Steve. I know this is a big challenge for the industry. So true. Thank you with helping here through this little educational podcast.
I always enjoy talking with you, Patricia. It's a pleasure. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.